On this special Holy Week and Easter edition of The World Over, a brand new exclusive interview with the director of the new film, Heaven Is For Real, Randall Wallace, joins us in studio. And later, an encore of my conversation with number one cable news talk show host and author of Killing Jesus, Bill O'Reilly. And a look at the work of two wonderful religious orders, Mother Dolores of the Poor Clares of Perpetual Adoration and Sister Lawrence Mary of the Little Sisters of the Poor will be here. Plus, a special tribute to Mother Angelica on her 91st birthday. The World Over Live begins right now.
Now, from Washington, D.C., Raymond Arroyo.
A warm welcome to all of you joining us in the United States and the world over. A very happy Holy Week and Easter to all of you. Bill O'Reilly, Mother Dolores Marie, and Sister Lawrence Mary are straight ahead. If you'd like to comment on tonight's program, send us a tweet at Raymond Arroyo, or you can drop us an email at worldover@ewtn.com. Lots to get to. Let's get right to it. My first guest is an Oscar-nominated screenwriter for Braveheart, director of incredible films such as The Man in the Iron Mask, We Were Soldiers, and Secretariat. And as if that weren't enough, he's also a novelist, a songwriter, an expert martial artist, and a committed Christian. This week, his latest film, Heaven Is For Real, opened in theaters nationwide. It is the true story of Colton Burpo, the four-year-old son of a small-town Nebraska pastor who experiences heaven during an emergency surgery. What happens afterward is anyone's guess. Take a look at this clip.
The pain that I suffered watching my son at close to death.
We're in trouble. Will you call some friends and pray for him?
The hospital said that your son was not expected to survive. Use the word miracle.
Your son had a near-death experience.
He saw things that I can't really explain.
I lifted up and I looked down. Mom was in one room, you were in another room yelling at God.
He's been out there staring for hours.
Is something wrong with Colton?
Why do you say that?
Sometimes he says weird things. You had a grandpa named Puck, right?
He died when I was about your age.
He's very nice.
You saw my grandfather? Where did you see him?
In heaven.
I want to believe him.
But everything he talks about is impossible.
You saw heaven?
What does it look like?
It's beautiful.
We all want to be supportive, but we can't have our town turn into a circus.
They don't believe me, do they?
Some people might be afraid to believe.
Don't you think we need to be talking about this life?
Do you think my son went to heaven?
Mark.
You don't have to worry. He told me everything was all right.
Making a difference.
Haven't we already had a glimpse of something?
From the first cry of a baby, the courage of a friend, the love of a mother, a father, I see it, so I believe it.
Do you?
Joining us now to talk about Heaven Is For Real, he's a co-writer on the film and the director, Randy Wallace. Thanks for being back on the show.
Great to see you,
so
my
good
friend.
To have you here.
Good to see you.
Tell me, when you first read this book, Heaven Is For Real, and millions have read it, what was your first reaction?
I was skeptical. My first reaction upon encountering the story of a boy who talks about heaven was, okay, he had anesthesia, he is the son of a pastor, his life was full of images. There is reality in the metaphor, but not in sort of tangible fact. But as I really explored the story, I began to feel, well, this is something like all the great stories. It makes us confront a deeper truth.
Did you meet with the Burpos, the couple and the little boy who had this experience before you agreed to do the movie?
Yes, I was planning to do the movie, but I wanted to see them and see if it would change my mind. And they're so grounded. They're so down to earth. There's nothing pretentious about them. The father is a pastor of a small church in Imperial, Nebraska, still a pastor. Yeah. He's a fireman, a volunteer fireman. He installed garage doors, sort of a tent-making ministry. Mm. And he's the kind of guy you'd want as a best friend.
Yeah, he's a very nice man. I met he and the family in Winnipeg when I came to see
you on the set there.
That was unbelievable. I mean, it was this shoot seemed to go so easily for you all. I mean, it was an amazing process. You finished early, as it turned out.
We did. We finished early. I had my issues before the shoot. Before the shoot, I was in the hospital with doctors planning to amputate my hand.
I remember this.
And my mother died about 2 months before we started shooting. And all of that in its strange way, and all things worked together for good. Mm-hmm. It prepared me, I think. And having this story that I was working on really comforted me at the passing of my mother.
The opening line of the movie, Greg Kinnear playing Todd Burpo, says, "Is heaven a hope or as real as the earth and the sky?" Why did you decide to open the movie that way and frame it the way you do? And we'll talk about that in a minute.
The real inspiration for me, Raymond, is, and I know you're the same way, you see God everywhere you look. Mm. The inspiration for me came in the Lord's Prayer. When this story is about a boy who goes to heaven, and there was no way, in my view, of making this movie unless we were going to give the audience an experience of a glimpse, at least, into heaven. Mm-hmm. And you know, the thought of how can you not be overwhelmed with the notion of trying to show what's heavenly.
Yeah.
And the real inspiration was that what we see is God's handiwork. When the earth is not ruined, when the earth is in its most beautiful form, we're seeing God's artistry, and that we could use the elements of our earth.
There was a peculiar thing at the top of the movie that I totally did not expect. It is a child painting an eye. Why did you choose that as your first image, the first thing we really see at the top of this movie?
I chose that image because this story is largely a mystery. It's suspenseful. Mm-hmm. I think in talking about it, this was your experience too.
Yeah,
you start to unravel this mysterious tale of what did he see and why did he see it? Mm-hmm. Why would God choose a four-year-old boy to reveal these things?
Right, at this moment.
And he didn't die either. It's not like
a near-death experience,
but it wasn't one of those where his brain stopped working, his heart flatlined, and that's even part of the mystery about how did he have this vision. Mm-hmm. So the girl painting the eye was a girl on the other side of the world who had a vision remarkably like his and who saw Jesus, and the Jesus that she saw was the Jesus that he saw.
Wow.
And that is quite a mysterious element of the story.
Yeah. Why did you decide to frame it the way you do? This is really a family drama. When you read the book, it's basically what the little boy saw, what Colton Burpo saw. This is it's a much richer tale in some ways. Tell me how you decided to frame it this way.
I thought that the element of the story that we could all relate to was the element of doubt, the element of how the father has to struggle. Most stories that are about a man of faith, a woman of faith, having a crisis, are that crisis being brought on by some tragedy.
Right.
This story is, what if someone you loved told you that everything you dreamed, everything you wanted, everything you hoped was true, that life was full of joy, that God loved you in this miraculous, magnificent way? And could you come to terms with that? Could you accept that? And that, to me, was the greatest struggle of the story.
And you see him also, Todd Burpo, wrestling with even his congregants at his church, who aren't quite buying this notion of heaven, or that his son even saw heaven. And that becomes another interesting catalyst in the course of their journey. I want to play people this little clip. This is the mother, Mrs. Burpo, talking to her son after his experience, and he met someone while in heaven. Watch this.
Mommy?
Yes, Colton?
Did you know I have a sister?
You didn't know that Cassie's your sister?
No, I have two sisters. You had a baby die in your tummy, didn't you?
Honey, who told you I had a baby die in my tummy?
She told me she died in your tummy.
What does she look like?
Like Cassie, but a little smaller, and hair like yours. In heaven, this little girl came up to me, and she wouldn't stop hugging me.
What was her name?
She didn't have a name. You guys didn't name her.
This is one of those shocking moments in the movie. I mean, you know, yes. We're a child that's deceased, and here there's this little boy meeting them. They didn't even know this child. Child was a miscarriage. Why did you decide to include it here? I know it is a dramatic moment in the book, certainly.
This story, as I came to understand as I made this movie, was that God sees our hidden wounds even when we don't know the wounds ourselves. That, to me, was the most miraculous part. That she carried this wound of having had a miscarriage. And I've experienced that in my own life. So many have. And it's not something we talk about. Yeah. And each person in the story has a wound. And, you know, if we had a disease and we knew it and we could go to the doctor and we could think, this is how I'm going to try to deal with this disease, that's one thing. But when we have something corrosive in our hearts, in our lives, in our souls, and that we've never gotten over the wound, and we just hide that from ourselves and pretend that we're not wounded, then we don't heal in the same way. Right. And this is a story about God reaching into their lives and healing those wounds.
No, it's incredible, and it's a beautifully told tale, and the images are spectacular, particularly some of these external shots are just, as you said, it's the hand of God. You see it in every frame. I want to talk about you for a moment. You grew up in Jackson, Tennessee.
Yes.
Tell me about your parents. Truman, particularly your father, and what they gave you, how this led you down this road of storytelling.
Well, my father was a traveling salesman, and while we have all the cliches of that, my father was the most loving guy. He never met anyone that he didn't think he could befriend. Huh. And he did that by seeing the good in them. He found a delight in them. My mother was more introverted, very strong. When we were soldiers, and I called my mother, and she said to me, "How are you feeling?" And I said, "I'm nervous because we're about to open the movie." And she said, "Why does that make you nervous?" And I said, "Well, people are going to be critical. That some people want to be critical." Mm-hmm. And my mother said, "Well, you know, honey, if they crucified Jesus Christ, there are going to be some people that don't like you."
Get over it.
Get over it. So my mother had that kind of toughness. Like, I don't care if people don't like me. Mm-hmm. My father wanted everyone in the world to like. He wanted to like everyone in the world. And that just gave me the spirit that no matter what happens, I can go, I can take the criticism and just be myself.
Yeah. And then you go to Duke Divinity School.
Yes.
And for a long time, you thought of, I guess during that period, becoming a pastor, but your vocation took a bit of a turn during that period. Tell me what happened. What was the turning point, if you will?
Well, Raymond, not to be presumptuous, but I really feel I'm very much like you. I wanted to live my life for God, for a greater purpose than just satisfying my own appetites. Mm-hmm. I wanted to find that way. And I, you know, there's nothing in my life more central than my faith. And I wanted to explore that, to find the ways that I could in the world as we find it, that I could be a man of God.
There was that wonderful moment, though. You meet your mentor there at Duke, and you were really wrestling with this vocation business.
Yes.
And feeling called to serve God because you were studying theology, I guess.
Yes.
You felt that would be the most normal path. And your colleagues are all going down this path, and yet you decide to go out to Hollywood.
Yeah, yeah.
Why?
Well, I felt that was what made my heart sing, was to write. And particularly then it was to write songs, and that seemed so frivolous. But what I felt when I was writing music was I felt the hand of God. I felt, as that great line in Chariots of Fire, you know, when I run, I feel God's pleasure. Mm. When I wrote, I felt God's pleasure. Mm. And I felt guilty to leave my friends who were gonna hold the hands of the dying, who were gonna comfort the sick. And I said to my pastor, you know, I don't know what to do. And he said, "Do you feel the call to be a pastor?" And I said, "No, though I know it's the greatest calling anyone could have." And he said, "You're wrong." the greatest calling you could have is the one God has for you.
And you found it. You start writing television series, a number of them, very successful. And then things sort of stopped.
Yeah.
Nothing was selling. And you and your wife go on a trip to Scotland, and suddenly things started changing. It took time. But what happened in Scotland?
It took time. I came across a statue of a man named William Wallace. And I
didn't know anything about him before then.
I knew nothing about him. I elbowed my wife and said, William Wallace, statue. Mm-hmm. And I asked the guard there at the castle, it was in Edinburgh Castle, who is this William Wallace? He says, our greatest hero. Only he said, our greatest hero. And said, honey, see, greatest hero, Wallace.
Here we go.
And I came across that story. And I thought, this is a great tale, but I don't feel yet equipped to write it. I'm not in a place yet that I can. It took me 10 years to become desperate enough to get down on my knees and say, I'm gonna write what I want to see, what I'm made to write, not what I think Hollywood wants to buy. When I wrote Braveheart, I had no idea that anyone would actually want that story.
And of course, the whole world wanted that story. And you created a production company, Wheelhouse Productions. And I know what it's dedicated to, and the type of stories it's dedicated to are really those you've committed your whole life to trying to create and indeed creating. Tell people about that and why you decided to call it Wheelhouse.
Well, there's a term in baseball of when a pitch is right in your wheelhouse, mm-hmm. meaning that's the pitch you can hit for a home run. Mm. Other batters, it might be different, but that's the one that where you have your power, where you have your strength. And it's funny, Raymond, I am asked sometimes why I've departed to make a movie like Heaven Is For Real, mm-hmm. when I've made movies like Braveheart. And I go, for me, there's no departure whatsoever. Braveheart is, to me, a profoundly spiritual movie.
Yep.
When people have asked me what research I did on it, I say, I read the New Testament. I mean,
because it was really a legend. There were a lot of holes in that story.
That's right. And you can see, you know, the pattern. And for Mel Gibson, when he sees William Wallace praying for strength, he understood instantly that mm-hmm. from the Garden of Gethsemane, I know what that prayer is about. And mm-hmm. as Jesus prayed that prayer, each of us at some point or another mm-hmm. are going to need to pray that prayer.
You said something, and I wrote it down. You can make profoundly captivating spiritual movies without religious garments. In this case, you really have religious garments in some ways, yes?
Yes, yes.
Was it easier or harder to do?
I think it was harder to do because for one thing, in our society, religion is one of the dirtiest words.
Yeah.
In my parents' generation, the worst thing you could be was a coward or lazy. But now the worst thing you can be is to be thought religiously intolerant. Yeah. It's been really interesting when we see the test audiences of Heaven Is For Real. We've tested it with people who go to church regularly and with people who never go to church, never attend a religious service. And those people respond just as powerfully to the story as do the people in church who respond overwhelmingly. But they're afraid to recommend the movie because they don't want anybody to think they're religious. But the question when we say faith-based audiences, mm-hmm. that's a lazy term.
Yeah.
Every human being wrestles with the question.
Yeah.
Every human
being. In some way. Do you see do you see this film as part of a trend? Let's face it, I tell everybody, this trend was really started 10 years ago in the modern era. 10 years ago, by Mel Gibson when he created The Passion.
No doubt at all.
That was really the beginning of this, the discovery, Hollywood's discovery of the audience that everybody else knew had been there all along, waiting.
Right.
But more recently we've seen Son of God, God Is Not Dead, for better or worse, Noah. Now Heaven Is For Real. Do you think the audience is sort of building to this? They've been and they're ready for this sort of film?
I think, as C.S. Lewis said, there's a natural law of undulation. You go too far one way, and then you need to come back. And I think people are really hungry for stories that are about mm-hmm. the true spirit. When we've been full of stories of superheroes, mm-hmm. I've often felt if a bullet bounces off your chest, you're not a hero for facing the bullets.
Exactly.
In the Passion of the Christ, you know, Mel showed the whip biting into Jesus' back, mm-hmm. Was a real whip, and it tore into his flesh.
Yeah.
These stories are about lasting questions, eternal questions mm-hmm. that don't ever go away.
What do you think that is? Why do you think there's this fixation on the superheroes? I mean, Hollywood now, the whole industry is basically predicated upon making Batman movies, Spider-Man movies, Captain America movies, Hulk movies, Thor movies, Superman movies. What is it? What is it in us as an audience that drives people to go and see endless superhero movies? Is that part of a spiritual craving, do you think?
Yes, I think it is. I think we are over-entertained, and we tend to equate. If I were asked what I think the greatest threat right now to our society is, it's the assumption that by being a spectator, you're being a participant.
Mm.
That we can just constantly have a screen that we can look at and try to be diverted from life. And I think we're starting to wake up to the hunger of needing authenticity. We want to feel real love, not manufactured love, not spectator love. Mm-hmm. We want to feel it powerfully. One of the great things I love about this movie is that children can see it as well.
Mm-hmm.
The whole family can see the movie.
Yeah, and that's rare, and that's very rare.
Yes.
But it also, I thought, for seekers, people who have an ill-defined faith or are wrestling with it or looking, it presents interesting questions,
right.
I think, and honestly does so. I mean, this is not kind of pre-manufactured saccharin that there's a preordained end. These people are really wrestling with the other answers, the other possibilities that sometimes the world offers when we hear about the miraculous or people who've seen to the other side.
Yes. In my experience is that outside the faith, people think that those within the faith have ceased to have doubts, have ceased to mm-hmm. deal with them. But all of us have that thought. What if you encounter something that you can't explain? The idea of a boy who says to his father, "I was in heaven, I saw it, this is what it looks like," is a provocative idea.
Mm. You in an interview once said Luke 9:25 is a resonant theme in so much of your work. What does it profit a man if he gains the whole world and loses his soul? How does that idea work its way and wend its way through from Braveheart to When We Were Soldiers to this newest film, Heaven Is For Real?
Well, for me, it's the issue of if I ceased to write and to try to make movies on what I believe, on what speaks to me, mm-hmm. I can't possibly speak to anybody else. Mm-hmm. And the idolatry of worshiping money, of thinking that money is God or celebrity is God, mm-hmm. is corrosive. Mm-hmm. It destroys you.
Yeah.
So if I think, as my mother said, mm-hmm. if what I'm really concerned about is what other people think of me, then I cease to be connected to what nourishes my soul and actually makes me alive.
Tell me what you're working on now. What's next?
Raymond, I have been really excited about the notion of looking at Braveheart, what Braveheart has meant, what it means to people. I still go around the country today and people come up and say, "Braveheart's my favorite movie ever."
Yep.
And I've been working on a book, Living the Braveheart Life.
Wow.
And I don't know where it'll lead me, but I'm really excited about doing that.
No, my sons and their friends, just seen this movie, and they're captivated by it. What is it? Is it because it's the Christ, it's the model of Christ in some ways?
Well, I do think so. And I also think that if we talk in abstractions, if we say, everybody says, "Oh, I believe in love." Okay, mm-hmm. fine.
Yeah.
But
what's the cost of love?
What's the cost? And what does it really mean? What does it look like? We did a screening of Braveheart in Texas a few years ago for a charity, and in the Q&A, a young woman stood up and said, "I don't have a question. I just want to tell you something. I'm 19 years old. 6 months ago, my fiancé died. Hmm. And he told me before he died, he wanted me to see Braveheart so I would understand the way that he loved me."
Hmm.
And I couldn't speak for about 5 minutes after she said that. And I think that's what all of my work is I hope, is about. Mm-hmm. Heaven is for real is to say this is the way God loves us. The idea of heaven is not even so much to for what eternity is. Of course it's that.
Yeah.
But it's also that we want to have life in the fullest here, now. Where does a baby come from? The same place that my mother went.
Beautiful. Well, you have lived the Braveheart life for many years, and I know there'll be many more, and I hope you'll let us continue getting a glimpse of it. Randy Wallace, always a pleasure. Thank you so much. Heaven is for Real, directed by Randy Wallace, is in theaters nationwide. Check your local listings, and be sure to go see it. It is a great film for the entire family this Easter and raises important questions. When we return, an encore of my interview with author and Fox News host Bill O'Reilly about his latest bestseller, Killing Jesus, When the World Over Live, continues. Stay with us.
Now, once again, Raymond Arroyo.
Welcome back to The World Over Live. For 17 years, the O'Reilly Factor has dominated the ratings in cable news. As if that weren't enough, he's become one of the world's best-selling authors. Bill O'Reilly's latest book, Killing Jesus, is still on the top of the New York Times bestseller lists. And he just released a version for children called The Last Days of Jesus. Now, some have criticized the book for its depiction of Christ's ministry and last days. I spoke with him at length last year about his reasons for writing Killing Jesus, the criticism he's received, and even his personal faith. Here's an encore of my interview with Bill O'Reilly. Bill, why was it necessary, after hearing and seeing this story told in so many ways, in so many mediums, why did you feel compelled to write this book now?
Well, I don't think it's all ever been put together in a historical sense the way we did it, contrasting the Roman occupation and what was happening in Rome to the early life of Jesus. We begin with him actually being hunted by Herod. And I don't think it, I have never seen it, and we, believe me, we went over everything that was written about Jesus. It all brought together the history of it. And it amazes me, now that we've sold about 700,000 copies, and I get a lot of letters, how little people know about Jesus, unless they come from a religious family. If you don't, if you're not raised in a religious family, you don't know anything about him. You know he was born on Christmas, and Christmas, you know he got nailed to the cross, but in between, you don't know anything.
It's lost.
Yeah.
Why separate the spiritual from the human? This is really the historical record, the human side of Jesus. The spiritual you kind of leave to the side. It's there. It's in footnotes. It's on the edges. But why not tackle the whole enchilada?
Because I'm not really qualified to write a spiritual book. That's not what I do. I'm a historian. So I just didn't feel that another spiritual book about Jesus coming from me would have done anybody any good.
Yeah, you said the Holy Spirit inspired you to write this book.
Because that's my belief system, not the specific book in the sense that I believe that there's an interactive God, as all Christians and Catholics believe, that God takes an interest in every human being, and that good things, inspiration, come from God. So I just clearly stated that, and then the secularists and atheists went wild trying to diminish me, but that's a core tenet of the Christian belief system. And certainly this book, because I was struggling, what do I write after Lincoln and Kennedy? What do I do? And then all of a sudden, bing, it just came in. And so I attribute that to the Holy Spirit.
I want to get into some of the issues you raise in the book. Some of my viewers have sent me emails since I appeared on your show. You've got to ask Bill O'Reilly this, so I will. Mary Magdalene, in the book, she is depicted as a prostitute. Now, that is a part of the Christian tradition. Recent scholarship and history would seem to indicate she's not a prostitute. Why do you all put her in that, cast her in that way?
We didn't believe the recent scholarship was based on anything compelling. We saw it, but the town where she came from was a notorious town for vice. And she was an outcast in the town. Do the math.
And the demons were cast out of her, the scripture
says. Well, I mean, I'm not going into the spiritual realm. The math was young single woman, unmarried. Very rare. Not accepted. Why? From a town that specialized in vice. So we believe that the historical portrayal of Mary Magdalene is accurate, and that Jesus took her as part of his entourage to show everyone that he was going to engage everybody. And of course, Mary Magdalene became one of his most loyal acolytes. Yeah.
Let's talk for a moment about the way the story unfolds here. You have the opening of his ministry being the turning of the tables in the temple, turning all the money changers' tables over.
Right.
That happens in three of the Gospels at the end of the ministry, not at the beginning. Why do you put it there? In one of the Gospels, it's situated earlier, but not where you all have it.
We believe it happened twice.
Twice.
All right. From the narrative that we saw in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and the Roman reports of this man who's disrupting, that the word that they used, disrupting, all right, society in Jerusalem. We believe that in early on, he confronted these people in the temple, the merchants and the money changers.
Right.
And then, of course, in the last 7 days, he replicated that, and that sealed his doom. Hmm.
I got an email the other day. This lady wrote on page 214, Bill O'Reilly writes, Judas Iscariot watches Jesus with a quiet intensity. How do you know that, Bill O'Reilly?
The descriptions of how Judas behaved as one of the disciples are pretty vivid, coming from John the Evangelist, who was there. Mm-hmm. John was, right. Mm-hmm. And Judas was an outsider, as we write in the book.
Right.
He wasn't part of the Galilee crew. He came from the south, spoke differently, and he was the treasurer, and he was a calculating man. So we basically took from what has been written about Judas and described it in a way that we believe he was calculating. Okay, if Jesus is God, they can't get him.
Right.
They can't get him. He'll call the legions of angels down and it'll protect him. But if he isn't, Judas Iscariot, want to be on the right side of this, so I'll cooperate with the temple authorities. That way I can't lose. Mm-hmm. And I think we depicted Judas the way he really was.
Okay. On the cross, Jesus, in your account, he says, I thirst. He says, it is finished. But he doesn't say, Father, forgive them. They know not what they do. Why not? Why did you decide that? If he can muster the breath to say, I thirst, couldn't he have possibly said, Father, forgive them. I know not what they do?
It's possible, but we don't think it was probable. Number one, you couldn't hear him. The bystanders were kept far away, so they wouldn't have been able to hear him. Mm-hmm. The only people who could hear anything Jesus said were the Roman execution squad, the five of them. Mm-hmm. We know he said he was thirsty because they put a sponge to his mouth.
Right.
We know that, okay? And it is finished, we believe, he could have said. But anything more than that, because he was like this, and you die on the cross by suffocation, all your energy has to be getting air into your lungs. Mm-hmm. To have a conversation is virtually impossible. Maybe one or two words. But we weren't sure, so we just left it out. Hmm. When we're not sure, we don't put it in.
What is this whole, this had to be you say it's a daunting, it was the most daunting of the books.
Very tough to write it.
What has it meant to you as a Catholic, personally, and has it deepened or changed your faith at all?
It hasn't changed my faith. I was always a loyal Catholic. That's the way I was raised. But certainly when you look at the two things that are phenomenal in the book, that strengthens anybody who's a Christian. Mm-hmm. Number one, why were thousands of people following this guy around?
Yeah.
Why? There were a lot of people saying they were the Messiah at that time,
yeah.
A lot. Yet thousands, literally thousands of people would show up. And there was no advertising campaign. There was no plane going over. Jesus will be on the mount at 3 p.m. Word of mouth.
No tweets.
Right. Word of mouth was driving people who had to eat, had to work to eat, to follow him. Number one, and that's indisputable.
Right.
All right. Number two, the most famous man who ever lived. Had no money, no infrastructure, nothing. How does that happen? So those two things we establish very clearly in the book. And so that if you do believe in Jesus, that he was God, I think that strengthens the belief that there was something extraordinary going on there. Mm.
Years ago at one of the conventions in Minneapolis, I wandered into a cathedral. And I hope I'm not revealing anything. It was in public, so I think I can reveal it. I walked in, it was an empty cathedral, and there in the front is Bill O'Reilly in prayer. kneeling.
And you didn't even know me, right?
I didn't know you at all.
You know who I was from TV.
I knew you were from TV, and I saw you from afar. And I thought to myself, I mean, you said a moment ago I was raised that way. The fact is you practice your faith.
Yeah, but I mean, I don't like to wear that on my sleeve, Raymond. I mean, I'm the biggest sinner on the block.
Welcome to my club.
If I see a nice cathedral, I stop in and say a prayer. Mm-hmm. I mean, but I'm not saying that I'm some kind of holy roller, and I'm not trying to proselytize in this book. I took this book on the same way I took on Lincoln and Kennedy. Mm-hmm. I just want to portray the subject vividly and accurately, and I believe I succeeded.
What do you say to those, USA Today and some others, who've taken some shots at the book? They say nothing new is revealed here, Bill O'Reilly.
No, it's a lie. I mean, you're a scholar of theology. Is that description true?
Well, I don't think it's true. I mean, I actually, there was new material
I'll put
here.
I'll forth that Raymond Arroyo knows more than Bob Mintzheimer about Jesus. I'll put that
with
forth.
Apologies to Bob.
Yeah. I'm not apologizing to him.
Okay, well,
They do that to diminish the book. The mm-hmm. secularists don't want people to read Killing Jesus because it heightens the awareness of Jesus. Yeah. And they see Jesus as a threat to their agenda of abortion or gay marriage, whatever it may be. Mm-hmm. So they want Bill O'Reilly selling 3 million copies of Killing Jesus, the last thing they want. Mm-hmm. So they're going to go, there's nothing new in the book, which is a bunch of garbage. There's tons new in the book, all right? And the other thing is the diminishment of me because I said, well, I got inspired by the Holy Spirit. Yeah. Is that an outrageous statement for a Christian?
People have
man?
Been saying that for centuries, from Michelangelo to the lady on the corner.
They think it's outrageous because they actually believe that mm-hmm. there's a God, and they don't. So, therefore, look at this guy. Look at how crazy he is. They both tried those tacks, and they both lost. Mm-hmm.
In the back of the book, there was something that I found interesting. It says at one point, several of the artwork featured from the collection of Bill O'Reilly.
Right.
Do you collect religious art?
Not religious art so much as historical art. Mm-hmm. I have some of it's religious, particularly because of this period of time, but it's mostly historical stuff that I collect. But some of the things we have in there are from my private
beautiful
collection.
Pieces. There's Jesus teaching in the temple. I thought, I'd love to see that one
in the
O'Reilly gallery.
It's a beautiful old thing that I picked up somewhere. I don't even remember where. But I tried to give a lot of myself in the book, but without beating anybody over the head.
Pope Francis, and I'll give you the final word, as you would say. What do you make of him? Is he changing the church, or is this a new face of continuity?
I don't know yet about Pope Francis. I kind of like him. I mean, he seems to me to be a humble man who wants to do good. Mm-hmm. Let's start there. Mm-hmm. Humble man, he doesn't have to be. He's in an exalted position, and he wants to do good. Yeah. And his whole history kind of shows that, right? All right. So right away, we start with that baseline of respect. I respect that. Number two, he's smart because he understands that the message of the Catholic Church has to come from somebody who non-believers will listen to. Catholic Church is a damaged institution, damaged all over the world. He's trying to be the messenger that is acceptable. So therefore, he's saying, look, we're not the judgmental people here. We want everybody to listen to
us,
all right? And we're not going to, condemn the gays, and we're not going to do this and alienate these people. We're going to be more accepting. This is a smart move because the more people listen, the more they might believe. But if they're not going to listen at all,
there's no opportunity.
There's no hope. Mm-hmm. So he's a good man. I could be wrong about that, but it looks like he's a good man.
Sure.
All right. And he's a smart guy for opening up the message to everyone, which is what I believe Jesus would have done. Can I tell you a quick story?
Sure. Please.
All right. I had a run-in with a cleric, a nun. All right. A couple of years ago. And that nun did a bad thing.
What did she do?
I'm not going to tell you.
She did it publicly or privately?
No, privately.
Okay.
She did a bad thing. All right? And I knew it, and she knew it. And I looked her in the eye, and I said, you think Jesus would have done that? Now, we're all sinners, as I said. But this one knew. This one was calculating and wasn't, it was a bad thing, and I'm sorry.
Yeah.
No. And I think that that's the litmus test for all of the quote-unquote spokespeople for the Catholic Church. Mm. Would Jesus do that? Would he act that way? And with the Mary Magdalene story, going back to that, his message was quite clear. We're going to embrace everybody here. Mm.
There's a possibility of redemption for everybody.
Right. We're not going to be making judgments and alienating. And I think that's what Pope Francis wants to do.
Mm-hmm. What's the next book? They say World War II.
Yeah.
If I guess it, will you tell me?
No. Because if I tell you what the next book is, Raymond, then someone will steal it.
Okay.
All right?
All right.
So there's a lot of stealing going on. Mm. It's a big World War II book. Everybody thinks they know what happened in World War II. You don't.
And it's killing somebody.
Yeah, they're killing. It'll be killing in the title. Okay. And we're working on it now, and boy.
A humdinger.
It's another one. It's not going to top Jesus. Jesus will be the best-selling book I ever write. I'm pretty
Bigger
sure.
than Bold Fresh.
Jesus the biggest will be the biggest book by far.
Wow.
Yeah. But we're going to write good history books as long as we can.
Killing Jesus, a History by Bill O'Reilly, as well as the children's version, The Last Days of Jesus, are available at bookstores everywhere and online. When we return, we'll take a look at some amazing religious orders drawing young women, one cloistered, one active, both known around the globe. The World Over Live continues in a moment. Stay right there.
Now, once again, Raymond Arroyo.
Welcome back to The World Over Live. Where would the world be without the contributions of women religious? I was recently joined by representatives of two vibrant international orders. Mother Dolores Marie of the Poor Clares of Perpetual Adoration is the abbess of St. Joseph Monastery in North Carolina and a daughter of Mother Angelica. And Sister Lawrence Mary of the Little Sisters of the Poor in Baltimore, Maryland. They told me about their work, their abundance of new vocations, and how you can help their efforts. Here's an encore of that interview. I want to start with what first drew you to this vocation, particularly in these times, and what are you hearing from the sisters and the women who come to you?
Well, I mean, for me, the obvious is adoration of our Lord in the Blessed Sacrament. So through, you know, I've worked at the network, and that atmosphere fostered a love for our Lord in the Blessed Sacrament, and then it just grew. And I knew that I had to find out if that's what the calling was for me.
What about you, sister? And what are you hearing from girls who come to you and say, we love your work, we want to see what this is, we feel called?
When I was in high school, I began volunteering with the Little Sisters of the Poor in Detroit. Mm. And there was such a peace in the home. And the sisters' love for the elderly just attracted me. And then I realized slowly that that's what God was calling me to do. Mm. And I've always been very happy in my choice and very grateful that God wanted me to be his own as a little sister.
I want to talk about both your work because I have seen it up close over many years. Your work, Mother Dolores, people say, oh, those contemplative, no, they're in there. What are they doing? They should do some active work. You're actually doing a great deal. Tell us about your work and this spiritual motherhood that's become such a centerpiece of what you do in North Carolina.
Okay. It's very simple because the Franciscan life is simple, and then I guess ours is simpler because our life is prayer. Mm. And that is a work hard to measure. You know, everybody in the world wants to measure things or progress report on things, but our life of prayer for the world knows no boundaries. So that is very straightforward in, you know, what our work is. And adoration in a spirit of thanksgiving. Mm. And then we really have taken up the call for the congregation of clergy to embrace the spiritual motherhood.
What does that mean?
Well, it is prayer in union in the image of Our Lady, Mother of the Eternal High Priest, and on behalf of the priesthood, the sanctification of the priesthood.
Mm-hmm. Beautiful. Sister mm-hmm. Lawrence, tell us about your beautiful work with the poor elderly.
The Little Sisters care for the elderly poor in homes throughout the world. Mm-hmm. And our homes are so different from nursing homes or assisted living facilities. Our homes are really homes where the elderly residents are the owners of the home in a sense. Mm-hmm. And we as Little Sisters are there to serve them, to care for them with love, and to have this family spirit in our home, and then to be with them as they are dying. This is the highlight of our vocation.
It's beautiful.
To kind of usher them into God's presence.
But prayer is the centerpiece of your life
as
well.
Without prayer, it wouldn't be possible.
Mm. And it distinguishes it. You feel it when you walk into your homes, and certainly you feel it in the chapels of all the poor Clares of Perpetual Adoration, including Mother's Shrine, and I know the one you're building. Now, we should tell people, you all are both facing a bit of a crisis in that you've got vocations coming, and in your case, Mother Dolores, you don't know what to do with them. Right. You now have five sisters?
Right. There's five of us.
But that's because that's all the beds you have at this time. So tell us what you're doing now, and we'll roll some footage of what you're envisioning and hoping to create in North Carolina.
Well, the awesome thing is that as we realize we're kind of pulling together some information, how far the Lord has brought us already, it was such a surprise. Mm. But like $2.6 million into our first phase, which is the purchase of the land, the architectural designs, the road design, furnishings for the chapel even already.
Wow.
But now we have to begin the second phase, which is the road work, the first part of the building. So we're trying to raise about $8 million if you happen to have any on hand.
Look, as Mother Angelica used to say, God's got a lot of money.
Yeah.
So we'll see what happens. But you're looking for help in raising the money to build both the shrine, the chapel,
right,
as well as your monastery.
Right.
How many cells do you envision?
Eventually, the third phase will be for 24 cells.
Oh, boy.
To keep up the adoration around the clock.
Mm,
yeah.
One an hour. Pretty good. Now, Sister Lawrence Mary, tell me about this wonderful program you all have, Live in Service program.
That's a program for college women or young single women who are perhaps thinking of a religious vocation and want to have some experience. It's a live-in program either during the college breaks or all summer, when the young women can come and live at one of our homes here in the U.S., get some pay as they are doing some work for us, and also experience something of our prayer life and our community life.
So it's sort of a come-and-see moment.
It is.
And you have, I mean, there are 2,000 sisters around the world. You've got 33 novices.
We do.
What are they telling you when they come? What are they looking for? I mean, on the surface, people look at this and young people look at this and say, oh, well, it's caring for elderly people who are poor.
But
what is drawing them? What do they see?
These young women see a value in the elderly person that so many people don't see.
Mm-hmm.
They see that these people are important, that they're loved by God. And they need to be loved in return. And they also see and they experience our deep prayer life, our community life, which unfortunately maybe so many communities don't have. Because we live together, we're there at the service of our elderly 24/7. It's a very strong community and family spirit in our home.
Mother Dolores, tell me, what has been the impact of going to North Carolina, Bishop Jugas inviting you in, great bishop, and what's been the response in the community, particularly as a contemplative? I mean, you're shut away from the world, and yet they've really embraced your mission there.
It's been an overwhelming, wonderful response. I guess because of our temporary situation right now, we've gotten to know even more people. Mm-hmm. So many young families, young women, again, who are interested in the life.
And why? Why do they come? Why are they yearning for a contemplative life and a cloistered life?
Yeah, well, it is a unique calling. With some, I think they start to see the emptiness of the world, and they know that there is a deeper. They want to go deeper, and deeper into the love of our Lord.
Mm. Tell me, sister, what is it about the elderly person's spirituality that you've observed over these years, and how has it enriched and deepened your personal life?
I can see that the elderly have this true longing for God, that they know their time to approach Him is quickly coming. Mm. It's also a time of prayer, of intercession for the needs of their families, for the church in particular. They pray a lot for our Holy Father, for our Archbishop, for the needs of the diocese, and for all the intentions that we confide to them. Because they know, as we do, that we can't live without the help of our benefactors, and they're always there to join us in prayer for all those who help us, who support us, and who enable us to live.
Yeah, well, it's incredible work both of you are doing. Before I go, Mother Dolores, just tell me, this is a beautiful piece of property that has been, and it's near the seminary, correct?
Yes, it's adjoining property to where the future seminary will be.
Oh, boy. Mm-hmm. So, and I imagine, as you said a moment ago, the spiritual motherhood, you'll be praying for those seminarians,
yes,
and the priests in the diocese. So it's a beautiful setup there. Well, I wish you both the best, and we'll certainly do the call out for you, because I know there are a lot of people who would and should support your work. Thank you both for being here and for your witness.
Thank you, Raymond.
Thank you. Before we go, this Easter Sunday marks the 91st birthday of our beloved Mother Mary Angelica. Not only is she the foundress of EWTN and Our Lady of the Angels Monastery, but she is also the spiritual mother to so many all over the world, including this guy. There would be no EWTN without her, no expansion of Catholic radio stations, no EWTN news. So much hinged on her incredible willingness to risk for God. Here are just a few of my favorite moments with Mother over the years as we wish her a very happy 91st birthday.
Trusting in Providence and operating on a budget based on donations, Mother Angelica has already accomplished what no one else has, the first FCC license ever granted to a monastic order to operate a television network. The network will broadcast news, religious, and entertainment programming 4 hours a day, 7 days a week in prime time.
I just got a call a little while ago. It says, how many cable systems? I don't know how many cables. Who cares? Maybe I have built this entire network for one person. Raymond's with me, and it's his birthday. Do you know what? How old are you?
I'm not telling you how old I am.
Well, do you want me to tell you how old you look?
Oh.
Didn't know what virtue is? Listen, it's hard. Don't you think?
You better believe it.
It's harder for me than maybe somebody that's been born rather placid and kind by nature. I'm not, you see.
Yeah, I've got the wounds to prove it.
Yeah, I know.
There are a series of reality television shows now on
the air.
What's
that mean?
Well, they put a bunch of cameras in a room or in a bunch of rooms. They invite 30 or 40 people over, and they have to live together for 3 months. There's a show called
Big
Brother.
Are they married?
No, they're not married. No. They find the most unlikely people you can imagine.
Who wants to live with anybody that isn't married?
Well, it's the purpose. I mean, can you imagine having a camera around, like in your cloister?
You have to be nuts.
Yeah. And these people are invited in. They willfully sign a contract to do this.
And what do they get for that, besides hellfire?
Well, that's it. I mean,
it just evolved. Cloistered nuns in television is without question one of the most ridiculous things that could have ever happened. One time, somebody said to me, we're very faulty, they said, why don't you air these people? And I said, no, I won't, because I don't think they're Catholic. He says, by what right do you have to say that? I said, I own the network. And he said, well, you won't always be there. And I said, I'll blow the damn thing up before you get your hands on it.
So they caught you on a good day.
Yeah, on a good day. How do you like that? One of the best days of my life.
That's right.
You can put that book you're writing.
Oh, sure, this is gonna be a whole new chapter.
Well, I love you. God loves you infinitely.
So many people sent me messages this week wishing Mother a happy birthday. They love you, and so do I. Happy 91st birthday, Mother, and a very happy Easter. Until next week, the show continues on Facebook and Twitter. Like me on Facebook, follow me on Twitter. The links are on my website, and I'll bring you the latest news and commentary throughout the week. We post the entire show there as well. And if you sign up for my free e-blast, I will send you all kinds of exclusives. Go to the center of the webpage, raymondarroyo.com. Sign up for the e-blast. Join us next week for EWTN News coverage of the canonizations of John Paul II and John XXIII from Rome. Check EWTN.com for details and times. Until then, we'll be scouting the world over for all that is seen and unseen. On behalf of the staff and crew of EWTN News, thanks for watching. I'm Raymond Arroyo from Washington, D.C. We'll see you next time. Bye now. We'll be right back.